Greetings. Welcome to Grace Lutheran Church's worship service for this second Sunday in Lent. And a very special welcome to the folk of King of Life who are also joining us for worship this day as Pastor Dorothy has a day off. And as some of you Grace folk know, I did half of my internship at King of Life. And so this is kind of a cool reunion of sorts, even though I can't really see any of them right now. But cool nonetheless that we're all together worshiping this day and praising our God in the season of Lent, in the season of a pandemic, and just through this difficult time in which we find ourselves. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in the sermon when we get there. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, i.e. you King of Life folk, there's a description above this video if you're on our website, or a description below this video if you're on YouTube. And in that description, we'll have a link to our worship bulletin. And you can open that up and download that if you want, or just have it open another window or what have you. And from there, you can see the full order of worship, the all the words of the liturgy and the sermon in full. However, all the words that you do need to know will be on your screen with your responses in the boldface type. Also in that description are some instructions on how we do our worship services here at Grace. And just for the sake of you folk at the King of Life who probably can't pause the video and read that real quick, we normally ask to have a few elements in your space just to enhance your at-home worship experience. The first being a bowl of water, a small basin of some sort in which we will interact with the water for the Thanksgiving, for baptism. We will have communion in this service, so you can have something small to eat and drink for time when we get to communion later on in the service. You can have that. You can have that. And also a lit candle. I ask everyone to have a lit candle for the duration of service, and that can be snuffed out at the end of the service when the altar candles are snuffed out. All of these are completely optional, but they are, again, designed in hopes to enhance your at-home worship experience. But that's all the announcements for today's service. I ask all of you who are joining us for worship to assume a posture that is conducive for worship, whether it be standing, kneeling, or most likely sitting at your desk or on your couch or wherever you may find yourself. As we quiet ourselves, calm our hearts and minds, and be prepared for worship. Let's just take a moment. We begin with the thanksgiving for baptism. We're gathered together in spirit, while in different houses, different area codes, and maybe even different time zones, by the grace and mercy of God, to worship, to pray, and to collectively lean on God's strength and wisdom. And this strength and wisdom leads us, guides us, and reminds us of the identity given to us through God's welcome, God's love, and the waters of baptism. While in itself, the water is just water. But when paired with the principles and properties of baptism, it becomes for us the mark, the symbol of God's unending presence and providence in our lives. You know, the waters of baptism and our relationship with it will always be with us, around us, and interacting with us as we look to it for life, for sustenance, and for connection with God and each other. And so those of you with water in front of you, you may use the water to mark your foreheads with the sign of the cross. Feel God present in your lives. Feel God's strength invigorating and empowering you. Feel God's love and blessing on you this day and always. Amen. Thanks be to God. We'll now sing our gathering hymn, Rise, Shine, You People. Strengthening grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the empowering love of God, and the reinforcing fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. From above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
This holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Let's pray. Holy God, your Son Jesus bore the cross for our sake and was raised from the dead for the redemption of the world. Give us the courage to take up our crosses that we might face this world as your faithful disciples, ready to engage, ready to serve, and ready to receive your love and strength through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The first reading is from the book of Genesis, chapter 17, verses 1 to 7 and 15 to 16. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, As for Sarah, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The psalm for today is Psalm 22, verses 23 to 31, which we will read responsively, whole verse by whole verse. Psalm 22. You who fear the Lord, give praise. All you of Jacob's line, give glory. Stand in awe of the Lord, all you offspring of Israel.
For the Lord does not despise nor abhor the poor in their poverty. Neither is the Lord's face hidden from them. But when they cry out, the Lord hears them.
From you comes my praise in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the sight of those who fear the Lord.
The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Let those who seek the Lord give praise. May your hearts live forever.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of nations shall bow before God.
For dominion belongs to the Lord, who rules over the nations.
Indeed, all who sleep in the earth shall bow down in worship. All who go down to the dust, though they be dead, shall kneel before the Lord.
Their descendants shall serve the Lord, whom they shall proclaim to generations to come.
They shall proclaim God's deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying to them, The Lord has acted.
The second reading is from the book of Romans, chapter 4, verses 13 to 25. The promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there a violation. For this reason it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist, hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, So numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which is already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words, "it was reckoned to him," were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We'll now sing our gospel acclamation. The Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you're setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain a whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes to the glory of his Father with the holy angels." The Gospel of the Lord. Let's pray before we begin. Holy God, open our eyes, ears, and hearts to see, hear, and feel you speaking your word to us, that your good news might empower us to receive and trust in your promise of salvation and grace through Jesus Christ our Lord. So, any of you been watching WandaVision on Disney Plus? You know, the season isn't over yet, so for the sake of those who are waiting for it to finish and then binge the whole season, I'll try to keep this completely spoiler-free. But if you're still worried about spoilers, feel free to just pause this video and go and catch up and then come back. Well, WandaVision is basically the latest installment of the MCU, the Marvel Cinematic Universe that is based on the superheroes of the Marvel Comics universe, which many of you know that I love. And I realize that some of you might be rolling your eyes right now, and that would be a shame because WandaVision, and the whole MCU for that matter, is really, really good. Anyway, without getting into too many details that will take forever to explain, this WandaVision TV series follows two of the superheroes who were romantically involved in the movies, Wanda and Vision. I know they got really creative with the series title. But the weird thing about the series is that the last time we saw Vision was in Avengers Infinity War, where he died. In fact, everyone in Wanda's life died throughout the movies. I mean, her parents, her twin brother, and now her significant other. And so this series is then about how she deals with the pain of all her loss, the trauma of having her heart broken over and over again, and the suffering that she's been through after all of her dreams of happiness have been shattered, in that she actually doesn't deal with any of it at all. Instead, she uses what is called hex magic, or maybe chaos magic if you've read the comics, and creates a completely new and different reality in which Vision is alive and that they're married, and she attempts to live happily ever after. But of course, it doesn't work. Maybe in the classic Disney fairy tale or princess movies it would, but not in the MCU, or else they couldn't make more movies, which translates to billions of dollars, which allows them to live happily ever after. Or we might think it works in the industry, at least. Because that's just a pipe dream, isn't it? I mean, to live happily ever after. I mean, how many of us can honestly say that we or someone we know are living happily ever after? Like no sadness, no setbacks, no suffering, no complaints, no complications, no conflicts, no pain, no problems, no pandemics. I'm pretty sure it's safe to say that none of us could honestly say that. In fact, I don't think anyone in the history of anyone ever could. This certainly was a case in Bible times. You know, the Bible is all about people trying to live happily ever after, and God saying, well, it all starts with Adam and Eve thinking that eating from the forbidden tree would give them happiness. Then there's Noah and his family that we read about last week that thought a brand new world would be great, but it turned out to be just like the old world. And then Abraham and Sarah, Abraham and Sarai, as we read today, that just want a kid and would do anything to have one, which cost them a lot more than they'd wagered on. And all that leads us to the birth of this nation of Israel that just wanted to get into their promised land where they were supposed to live happily ever after, but things just kept getting in their way. You know, like the Babylonians, the Assyrians, and the Romans. It's like they just can't escape life's problems, hurts, and suffering. But then murmurs of a Messiah started. You know, one who would bring balance to the force, free everyone from the matrix, and restore Israel to all its intended glory. And this gave people hope. They put their trust in a brighter tomorrow. There was a new faith that happily ever after might finally be attainable. And he actually showed up. A bit less religious than they thought, but still a breath of fresh air. And perhaps more carpentry than they expected, but he still checked off a lot of those boxes. Maybe not as mighty and in your face as the prophecies alluded to, but he was the one. And they were sure of it. So let the good times roll. But then, as we read today, he says something weird. He doesn't talk about putting together a plan to overthrow their oppressors and free them from captivity, but instead he talks about suffering and dying at the hands of his enemies. Essentially, these words just grab Israel's collective heart, rips it out of its metaphorical chest, and smashes it into tiny bits. God forbid, that can't happen. Our hopes of happiness, our expectation of elation, the promise of peace, gone. Really? Are we just doomed to live in perpetual torment and never be happy? Was this all a pipe dream? Is life really just suffering? Well, brace yourselves, because he's not finished. He then says, if we want to follow him, we need to first pick up our crosses. Our cross. Let's not forget that the cross in those days wasn't a fancy jewelry piece that it is today, but it was only known as an instrument of pain and humiliation. And not a weapon for defense, mind you, but a tool to oppress you literally to death. It was used to prove a point that we are but powerless against the evils of the world. It was used to make an example of anyone who thought they were better than the ruling government. It was used to bring even more suffering to an already suffering people. So, like we talked about last week, yeah, life is suffering. And we don't have the powers or hex magic to recreate reality like in WandaVision. We don't have the ability to rewrite our lives so we can live happily ever after. We just don't seem to have what it takes to pick up those metaphorical crosses that plague our lives, that hold us back, that just suck the literal life out of us. Life is suffering. And so we hide our pain. We're ashamed of our problems. We're embarrassed to ask for help. But Jesus says no. Don't deny the hardships we face, because that is part of being a child of God. Don't mask the brokenness of life, because that is what he has come to heal. Don't try to cover up our deep battle scars, our desolation, our depravity, because that is what joins us together as a community, a people, a kingdom in need of a Savior. See, it's in life's problems that we can lean on God's strength. It's in the ups and downs of life that we can rely on God's providence and grace. It's in facing the evils that plague us that we can truly see God on our side, holding us, redeeming us, and lifting us off our crosses and bringing us into the life that truly is life. A life not free of problems and pain, but a life that knows the fullness of God's peace, relationship, and love. So this isn't to say that life will suddenly be easy, because it won't. It isn't to say that we'll no longer suffer, because we will. It isn't even to say that all our problems will vanish in the blink of a magical hex, because that's not even possible in the real world. But it is to say that we can be healed in our brokenness. We can be saved from within our pain. We can feel joy in God, even in the midst of difficulties in life. Not that we can just ignore or brush off those difficulties, but we can accept suffering as a part of life. But it doesn't control us. It doesn't define us. And it most certainly does not have the last word in who we are or whose we are. For God has declared us from the beginning of creation as God's own forgiven and redeemed race. And so we can pick up our crosses and follow Christ, because in Christ our yoke is easy and our burden light. Not because they aren't there, but because we know we have someone beside us, journeying with us and helping us carry this seemingly unbearable load. Yes, life can be painful with all these things that it can throw at us. But we are given tools and truths to help us battle it. Life can be difficult, but we are given strength and the support of a community to help us withstand it. Life is suffering, but we do not suffer alone and are reminded that God is with us. God resides in us and around us, and God loves us beyond anything we can comprehend or imagine. And because of that, while life can remain suffering, life can also be good. So in this season of Lent, may we embrace our crosses that might hinder us but don't define us, that we could face them and face ourselves and see and remember just how loved we are as God's blessed and beloved children. Thanks be to God. Amen. We'll now sing our hymn of the day, "Take Up Your Cross," the Savior said. With all the disciples of Christ, let us confess the Christian faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Strengthened to pick up our crosses to follow Christ, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Each petition will end with, Divine God, and you are all invited to respond with, Hear our prayer. Divine God,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, we give you praise and glory, for we stand in awe of you and all that you do. Remind us always of your presence with us, that we may face our trials with confidence and hope found in you. Divine God,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, we assemble together in your name to praise you and serve you and neighbor, proclaiming your good news and sharing your love. May our ministry to our neighborhoods be faithful and pleasing in your sight, that all people might recognize you and your grace living in us. We pray especially for our neighboring faith communities, our partner Anglican Church of Canada, our Bishop Greg, Assistant to the Bishop Kathy, and National Bishop Susan, and our companion congregations of the BC Synod. In particular, we pray for Mount Olivet Lutheran Church in North Vancouver and their pastor, Carolina Gloucester, and for Christ the King Lutheran Church in Surrey and their pastor, Lorianne Bouton Crawford. Divine God,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, you feed us from the ends of the earth and you satisfy us with your providence. Strengthen us in our care for this planet and all that is in it, that it may continue to feed and house us for generations. Divine God,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, you rule over the nations and families that bow before you. May your grace be known in all countries, cities, and communities, that all people might know of and reflect your love and grace on others, allowing us all to live in peace and harmony. We pray especially for Soliana Emmanuel, that her journey into our country not be hindered too much more by the pandemic, and that she might be able to enter soon. Divine God,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, you do not hide your face from us, but you hear us when we cry out to you. We pray for those among us who are sick, who mourn, or who feel lonely, that your love might bring us all into healing and wholeness. We pray especially for Paula, Bev and family, Beulah, Ron, Tessa, and Nico, Laura, Candy, Thomas, Cindy, Linda, Henry, those who have contracted or have been affected by COVID-19, and all we name aloud or quietly in our hearts at this time. Divine God,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, even the saints of the past continue to kneel and bow down in worship, for your love and grace are eternal. Remind us of our connect to those who we loved and lost, that their lives of faith might inform us in our actions and decision-making, allowing us to set a good example for the generations to come. Divine God,
hear our prayer. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray. Trusting on your strength and mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. And as we just shared peace virtually with each other, you may share peace physically with those who are with you in your homes, or virtually with those who are watching the service same time as you, with whatever means you have in front of you as we are prepared for communion.
Peace of the risen Lord Jesus, the peace. peace of the Lord is among us right now. So open yourselves to receive it. The peace of the Lord is among us right now. So open yourselves to receive it. The peace of the Lord, the peace of the Lord, the peace of the of the Lord kept within cannot live. So open yourselves now to share it. The peace of the Lord kept within cannot live. So open yourselves now to share it.
Let's pray. God, our strength, you sustain us with your grace and you feed us with your word. May this humble food before us serve as a reminder of your gracious blessing in and through us. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who strengthens and empowers us as his disciples, joining us together with all the choirs of angels, the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven in praising your name with this unending hymn. Give you praise and glory, for we stand in awe of you and your grace and mercy. You don't hide your face from us when we call, but you hear our cries and answer them. So we praise you in our community and congregation, and gladly serve you and proclaim your love to the world. For you feed us with your word and nourish us with your dominion. You continue to bless us by sending to us your Son, Jesus, to reveal to us just how deep and wide your love and grace are. Because on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus went and sat with his friends for a meal and taking some bread, he gave thanks for it, broke it and shared it and said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Then after they ate, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and shared that, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." It is through this food that we can see how strength is manifested in love, allowing us to proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Again, we kneel to you, O Lord. We bow down in worship and we proclaim to you all glory and honor through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit as one God, now and forever. Amen. Now, as we are strengthened collectively by the Holy Spirit, let's pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let's taste and see God's steadfast love and faithfulness. Let's pray. Holy God, we again praise you for feeding and nourishing us with your word, graciously given to us through your covenant with us and our ancestors, empowering us to pick up our crosses and follow you in your wisdom and truth and love through Jesus Christ. Amen. And now may God, our Creator, bless you and strengthen you. May God the Christ teach you boldness and grace. And God, our Counselor, journey with you, holding your hand and granting you peace, both now and forever. Amen. We'll now sing our sending hymn, Lord Jesus, you shall be my song. Crosses and follow Christ.